Okay, so today we're going to talk about blockchain technology and give you a high-level overview of what it is and how it works. Blockchain, it emerged in 2008 out of cryptocurrency, specifically Bitcoin. There was a white paper published, and that's really where it all started. So we start, I guess, by defining what it is. Blockchain technology is a distributed, decentralized system in which all parties have an entire record and can view the transactions that took place. It's a decentralized and distributed network, and I can draw that out to explain what a decentralized distributed network actually is. So in a classic centralized network, you have a central node to which all other nodes in the network connect to. In a distributed system, you might have clusters of nodes with a few links between them, something a bit like this. But if this node is knocked offline, you lose the part of the data that was stored on that system. In a distributed system, like a sort of peer-to-peer network, you have something a bit more like this. Here you can think of, talking a bit back in database terms, your database is sharded and distributed in components, parts across your network. In this distributed, decentralized solution, all parties have a complete record of the database and the system combined together to act as one single database, with each individual node having a complete copy of all transactions in the case of blockchain. So here you've got centralized, here you've got a decentralized network where you've got clusters with only a few nodes connecting the individual clusters. And here in this more sort of lattice pattern, you've got a distributed and decentralized network. You can think of the blockchain system as a distributed ledger, or in sort of old-fashioned database terms, a transaction-based database. That's what it fundamentally is. It stores a ledger of transactions. And it's also immutable, which is to say, it can be updated, new sets of transactions can be added to it, but it can't, once something's added, that block cannot and should not be changed or mutated any further. The core technologies that underpin blockchain is hash codes, hash puzzles, Merkle trees, and public-private key cryptography. In the sort of common parlance of Bitcoin, you have what's known as a Bitcoin wallet that's actually your public key in terms of private public key cryptography. I know there's an earlier Computerphile on public private key encryption. But essentially, in the case of a blockchain, you have your wallet, your public key, and your private key. And an interesting thing about at least the way Bitcoin is implemented on the blockchain technology, it's all or nothing. So the total wealth of my current wallet has to be spent in a transaction. So if I've got five Bitcoins using the Bitcoin technology, and I only want to send one to you, then I send one coin to you and four back to myself, but I have to do this sort of circular transaction. I basically say that one Bitcoin that I send to you, I don't necessarily know you, I don't know who you are, there's no reason for us to have met or me to even know your name. What I'm really saying is the wallet that is labelled by this public key, the person who owns the corresponding private key to that public key, I'm authorising them to take ownership of this one Bitcoin. And that's how public-private key encryption is used. It's a means of legitimizing and authoring transactions to say that, yes, I have said you can spend this amount. I wish to transfer this amount to you, and you know that transfer originated from me, not somebody else on the network posing as me. The other thing is hash codes and Merkle trees. Actually, I can probably draw this out. Another interesting thing about the way hashes work is for a given input, if I have, ABC is my input, and I put that through a hashing algorithm, and I get the output, 05BC. I only have to change this marginally. Say I add A, B, C, and I add D to it, and it will completely change the corresponding hashcode. So you only have to change the input in a small way to get a drastically different hashcode coming out that will be of the same uniform length as the preceding one, despite the fact the input was of a different length. You can think of it as like labeling it with a... I've got to use unique carefully here, because there are, in occasions, you do get hash collisions where different input resolves to the same hash.
Sure,
but you're aiming towards uniqueness. And the idea is, you can think of it as like a fixed length signature for a given input. So how this features further in blockchain is blockchain technology, the transactions we talked about earlier, are grouped together. You know, you can think of transactions when they first are published to the network as existing out there in the ether. And then the job of, you might have heard of sort of miners in blockchain technology, the job of a miner is to gather a bunch of these transactions together, form them into a block, and the process of doing that is what involves hashing. And the process of checking that a block remains immutable and hasn't been changed, it goes on to Merkle trees, which I'll draw in the next diagram. But essentially, once I've formed my block, my block has a corresponding hash code. And how Merkle trees come into it, if we start with basic blocks of content that we want to represent in our tree structure, in generating our next nodes in our tree, I'm just going to use H to represent a hash function of A and B. And the value of that comes to label this node in our tree. Likewise, over here, we take the hash of B and C. And then here, at our top level, we take the hash of the hash of A and B and the hash of B and C. And that represents our next level up in the tree. And the interesting thing about this structure and about hash codes is, if we remember from this diagram, you only had to change your input a tiny bit to change the output. So if I change this base content, I make it lowercase rather than uppercase, for example, this will then change. So this hash code will become valid, as will this, and it will flip-flop and filter back up. And that is the core of blockchain technology in terms of how blocks are stored and how it's in a distributed system where no one knows anybody else, how you know and can be certain that the transactions haven't been tampered with, because everyone can see this chain of blocks. Having talked about some of the underlying data structures, to give an example of how transactions are grouped into blocks and blocks are grouped into chains. So you can think of your ledger of transactions. You can think, when your transactions are first formed on the network, they're sort of out there in the ether, these sort of loose transactions that need to be grouped together into blocks. In a network, anyone who takes on the role of a miner, their job is to grab some of these transactions down from the ether, put them into a block. If I draw a block here, and a block has several things in it. It has the set of transactions, A sends something to B, B sends something to C, and so on and so forth. It also has the hash value of any previous block that was in the network, going back to that Merkle tree structure. Additionally, it has something known as a nonce value, which is just a randomly guessed value to impact the signature hash of this block. So you hash the combination of the record of transactions, the hash value of the previous block, and this nonce value to generate a hash code that uniquely labels this block. Now, the reason behind the nonce value is to solve a hash puzzle. This final hash code that labels this block, your hash puzzle says, you know, it has to start with four zeros. So what a miner does, he groups his transactions together and he puts in random guesses for that nonce value until this hash value that labels this block satisfies the criteria of whatever the hash puzzle is.
Where does this hash puzzle come from?
So it's part of the mathematics of the blockchain network, and it's a way of certifying that a block is legitimate, and that it's agreed upon, and it's a way of managing the distributed nature of the network, because anyone can take any collection of transactions they like that are sort of out in the open that not yet formed into a block and try and create a block. And there's this sort of mathematical race of sort of compute power to solve this puzzle. And the first person who solves it, or the first group of people that solve it, they're the ones that generate a block that goes onto the chain. So it's a way of managing the fact that everybody is free to try and create blocks to add to the chain. So what happens then when, say, two people both happen to solve a block at the same moment, at precisely the same moment? Now, this is rare, but does happen. And in those instances, you can get forks in blockchains. The people in the network that see one block added go off and try and build blocks on top of that block, whereas the people that see a different block that's been added go off and try and continue the chain in another direction. So how is that resolved across the network? How is it that everyone has this single agreed upon ledger? Well, what happens is that the longer, essentially there's a sort of a democracy throughout the network, that the longest chain is the one that everyone agrees that they should take. And the mathematics are such that you're unlikely to sustain forks for a long period of time. As you know, people are looking all the time to update their current ledger to the longest chain. Suppose, to keep it simple, we have five people in our network and we have a forked chain. So we have two, in this instance, we have two competing chains. It only takes three of those sort of five to have seen the longer of the two chains for there to be a consensus of this is the, this by majority vote, as it were, we're going to reject any chain that's shorter than the longest chain the majority of the people on the network have seen.
What happens to any transactions that have happened with the shorter chain in that instance?
So in the shorter chain, that's where you're kind of, if your transactions are in that group, you're out of luck. They go, to the extent that they go back into the ether, they're not yet codified or incorporated into the blockchain, and so not processed, not legitimate.
Does this, all of this mean that it's actually a slower system than some?
At the moment, no. It's happening very quickly. At the moment, blocks are, I use Bitcoin because it was the first system and one of the most widely adopted. But in the Bitcoin system, blocks are created, the mathematical complexity of that hash puzzle is on a sliding scale to reflect the compute power of the network at any given point, such that blocks will be created on average every 10 minutes. The further back in the chain a particular block is, the less likely it is for that chain to be sort of found to be a shorter fork and discarded. So the current waiting period is, say, before counting the money in your wallet, let six blocks be created. And at the moment, that's an hour. So it's not instantaneous, but it's not too long to wait. And at that point, there's a very slim chance that your transaction is going to go back into the ether and then, to be reincorporated in a block later on. If you are in the unfortunate circumstance where you were part of that shorter fork of the blockchain and your transaction hasn't been accepted and it's been thrown back into the ether, you're just waiting for another miner to come along, grab that series of transactions and try and build another block.
You mentioned to me before we even started filming about the fact that there is going to be a point at which no new bitcoins get made.
That's correct, yes.
Is that mean that this mining will stop at that point?
No, but how you will be compensated will change. So at the moment, bitcoins are sort of being introduced sort of slowly through the mining process, in that you're being financially rewarded in bitcoins. I think at this point in time, the creation of a block, it merits six coins in the wallet of the miner, or as is commonly the case now with people grouping compute power together, the group of people that are made up a sort of mining pool. And at the point where all Bitcoins have been introduced, you'll no longer gain financially from mining in that regard. How you will then gain is through transaction fees. And this is where, you know, people can give up a certain amount of their transactions. You say, I want to send you a single Bitcoin. I've got 5 in my account, like I said before. Rather than sending 4 back to me, maybe I send 3.5 back to me, and I say, give the other half to the miner. And so in that way, you'll be financially compensated for the work of mining.
Suppose it's a bit like a currency exchange or PayPal. They all take their fees, don't they? So is this just like the distribution is these miners are effectively acting like the agents at the currency exchange?
Well, it is, to the extent where you know, there will be these transaction fees, which at the moment, you know, are sort of not taking a big part of the network because people are still getting money just from doing the computational work of solving the hash puzzles. But as a system evolves and relies more upon transaction fees, then yes, they will have more of a role to play within the network, but they're still likely to be far below your standard transaction fees for exchanging, you know, dollars to pounds. From its original conception, there, you know, it was only ever intended and designed to be 21 million Bitcoins in existence, and you think of it like your radioactive half-life controlling the release of those Bitcoins, and how that's reflected is the level of reward for mining. So every, I think it is every 21,000 Bitcoins in the Bitcoin scenario that are produced, the reward for mining and creating a block is halved. And so you're introducing half the amount of Bitcoins to the network as you were previously, and so on and so forth, until eventually all 21 million Bitcoins have been introduced to the network.
This same process in reverse, using the same key, and then they get hello back out the other end. And that's nice and simple, and it works, and it was once sort of the only way that people did things. But it has a problem, which is you both need to know what